Recorded Books Incorporated presents an unabridged recording of Becoming Rosemary by Francis M. Wood, narrated by Barbara Caruso.
Chapter 1. Rosemary. Rosemary is a watching child. That is what the Indian told Khan during one of their long, absolutely silent conversations. She has eyes like a damselfly. She looks frontward, backward, sideways. Rosemary is 12 years old, Khan replied, as if Rosemary's age explained everything. And Rosemary, sitting on the bank above the river, watching, spying, hoping to hear, looked from her sister on this side of the river to the Indian on the other side. She heard nothing. She didn't see a mouth move. Rosemary picked up the end of her braid and chewed it. "Ach," she said. And hers was the only human voice that the river heard that day, unless you counted the almost voices from behind the waterfall up above the bend. Rosemary, when she was lonely, did count those voices. Murmurs and calls and songs that she could never quite hear, that sounded as if they were at the end of a tunnel, that perhaps came from a promised land far away. "Ah," Rosemary said again. She dropped the straw-like taste of her hair and stood. She didn't try to be quiet as she walked away. She liked the crinkle of last autumn's leaves beneath her bare feet. She liked the feel of kid leather soft leaf flesh, the bend and snap of leaf bone. Her walk was stately at first, like that of a princess or queen. But then her toes began to curl, and her feet began to skip, and soon she was running up the little path that she shared with rabbits and wild turkeys to the kitchen garden behind her home. "They're doing it again," she told her mother importantly. "Hmm," said Althea. "They don't say anything. They just sit and look at each other." "You don't have to talk to be friends." "I wish I had a friend," Rosemary said. Her mood changed abruptly. This was happening to her now more and more often. She would feel one way, and then a moment later she would feel something completely different. It was unsettling. Althea looked up at her youngest daughter. "You have many friends," she said gently. Rosemary squatted down beside her mother and began pulling lettuce. "I wish," she said, and she sat back on her heels, "that I was rich and smart and beautiful. And then you wouldn't be my Rosemary," said Althea. "You would be just like all the other rich, smart, beautiful girls. You wouldn't be you." "Sometimes I wouldn't mind," Rosemary said gravely, "not being me." Althea laughed. "This is the first lettuce," she said, and her voice was full and rich and satisfied. "For the first lettuce salad of the season. We'll have it with cooked eggs and blackberry vinegar." But Rosemary was standing up again, her collection of lettuce leaves held loosely in the front of her shift, her hands holding the cloth away from her body, her long, bare, scratched legs visible to her thighs. "I'll take these in," she sighed. "Tell A2 to put them in cool water," Althea called after her. A2 was the only one of the family inside the house. She was clacking at her loom. She had pushed and shoved and heaved until the loom now stood before the front doorway. The afternoon sun slanted in through the front door, glided over the loom, printed a pattern on the floor at A2's back, and then before it could peter into shadow, joined up with the glare of light that barely intruded through the back doorway. A2, the center of all this sunshine, was muttering under her breath. Blue, then white. White, then blue. Her feet and hands were nimble and skilled. The cloth, a coverlet for a neighbor who had promised a baby goat in exchange, shone prettily in the light. "Etu," said Rosemary. "Oh, stop it," said Etu. "Just stop it." And she stopped herself, her right hand over her left, her feet teetering on the treadles. "You always tangle me up. Why do you have to talk? Why does anybody have to talk? Do I have to tell everybody this 1,000 times? Don't talk." "Mama wants you to put the lettuce in cool water," Rosemary said in an injured tone of voice. "Do it yourself," said Etu. Her left hand crossed her right. Her feet began to work, and she returned to the mathematical intricacies of her loom. Rosemary sighed. She walked around Etu to the table, put her finger into a jug of water, considered, and decided that the water was cool enough. She took down a flat china bowl from the cupboard and dumped in the lettuce. She looked back at Etu. Sometimes Rosemary couldn't decide which of her two sisters she liked better or liked less. Etu was certainly the prettier. There was no disputing that fact. Khan was taller than their father. She had wider shoulders and bigger feet. Etu was just tall enough to look slender, just small enough to appear dainty, and just graceful enough to seem sweet. But unlike Khan, Etu was often crotchety. Rosemary left her second sister and wandered out onto the porch, then down to the hard-packed earth, where a few chickens were anticipating supper. "Not yet, Chloe, not yet." Rosemary knew all the chickens by name. They were her special charge. She raised her arms above her head, stretched, yawned, and looked to see what she could see. The garden where her mother still worked, the woodshed, the chicken house, the barn. Beyond that, the field where her father plowed the earth with the family's one ox. Surrounding it all, the forest, the wonderful, wonderful forest. The forest where right now the mountain laurel was coming into bloom, and the Solomon seal, and the coral honeysuckle, and the sundrops, and the green and purple jack-in-the-pulpits. Where Rosemary stood, the sun was a hot helmet upon her head, but in the forest, the sun would be far, far away. That's what she would do, she decided. She would return to the forest. She headed around the far side of the house, away from the kitchen garden. She saw Thomas Small coming up the wagon path. "Hello, Thomas," she said. "Rosie," he answered. Rosemary skipped forward to meet him. Thomas carried a length of rope in his arms, rope that Rosemary remembered as having been borrowed from her father. Thomas glanced toward the front door. Etu's loom still clacked with a beat as perfect and regular as a song's. Beneath that beat, Rosemary listened very carefully, Etu's voice rose and fell like water. "I wouldn't disturb her," Rosemary warned Thomas. "I wouldn't go near her today." Thomas continued walking toward the front door. "She's not nice at all," said Rosemary, "and if you disturb her, she'll hate you." Thomas frowned. "Of course, she doesn't like you very much anyway," Rosemary remarked thoughtfully. Thomas flushed. His steps faltered, halted. He turned sharply right and marched toward the barn. Rosemary lingered around the wagon path until he came out of the barn without the rope. Without another glance at her or the front door, he marched back home. "Well," Rosemary said softly to herself. She walked between field and pasture, waved to her father when he looked her way, and then, when he wasn't looking, folded herself into the forest like cream being stirred into a pudding. The sun stopped. The heat stopped. She was standing at the bottom of a great green depth, inhaling the moist and slightly bitter breath of leaves. The air was as thick as water. The light was milky and pale. Rosemary raised her arms, and as if she were swimming, followed a pathless trail to a spy tree from which she could again see Khan and the Indian. They sat as before, exactly as before. The Indian, on his side of the river, sat cross-legged but straight-backed, a hand on each knee. He wore a loincloth and a farmer's hat. Khan, 20 stepping stones across from him, rested with her back against a tree. Rosemary eyed the stepping stones. She wouldn't have been surprised to see a rock, even a boulder, suddenly rise up and turn end over end, splashing water like a fish. Rocks sometimes did that when Khan was around. But today, the rocks lay still. Khan wasn't in a playful mood. She was resting. She wasn't, Rosemary observed righteously, doing any kind of work at all. Rosemary, being a good worker and a producing member of the family, went to look for ginseng. She walked carefully this time, with her head down, looking for 3 leaves, 5 leaflets, and a cluster of green-white flowers. She walked where the oak and hickory leaves, hundreds of years deep on the forest floor, were crushed down to a loam that was as dark as coffee. There she found her leaflets and her flowers. With a pointed stick, she began to dig. At first she dug determinedly. Then she dug with pleasure. She liked the crumble of the earth in her hands, its rich, rich smell. It was a smell that made her think of Christmas cakes and home, of her mother's kiss and her father's smile. The earth was all the pleasures of the familiar. The ginseng root, when she found it, was wealth, foreign lands, excitement. Whenever Rosemary gathered a basket of ginseng, her father took it to the mill. The miller sold it to one of the traveling merchants who came down the road from the courthouse town, many miles away. The merchant carried the ginseng for hundreds of miles until he reached the ocean. Then the ginseng traveled for thousands of miles on a ship until it was sold in a country where the people were actually yellow. Yellow people! Not pink or pale brown, like most of the people Rosemary knew. Not black brown, like the squire Seth, or reddish brown, like the Indian. But yellow. The yellow of a black-eyed Susan, of a buttercup, of a sundrop at the field's edge. The sundrop was the prettiest yellow, almost the color of the sun itself when the sky was especially blue. That was the yellow that Rosemary chose for those wonderful, distant people. Sundrop yellow skin and black, black hair. Nobody had ever told Rosemary what color their eyes might be, so in most of her musings she painted them green, bright green. She was digging ginseng for magical people with eyes the color of grass in sunlight. The root, when she finally had it out of the ground, was as long as her forearm and as wizened as a newborn baby's face. Rosemary hefted it and, with old experience, guessed that it weighed about 0.5 pound. Proud of herself, she ran down to the river, where she washed her hands. With peaceful satisfaction, she bunched up her shift and waded along the river's edge, looking for a rock large enough to sit on. Ah, she breathed, and for a long while she stood in the water, not moving. Before her, on a wide flat rock, a dozen young butterflies pulsed their wings. Open, closed, open, closed, open, closed. From where she stood, Rosemary could see the sticky film on those wings. Even as she watched, the stickiness dried, and one butterfly and then another took flight. They flew like titmouse chicks, new from the nest, traveling up with the breeze, down with the wind, their paths determined by the air around them, not by their skill. Ah! Rosemary sighed again, and she was happy. All the butterflies were in the air now, as yellow as autumn leaves. Now they would learn to fly. Now they could take care of themselves. With their wings spread and dried, their danger time was past. Not one was starting adult life with glued wings, a cripple. Rosie! The call was faint but clear. It was her mother, Althea, calling. Rosemary pounded out of the river, letting her shift fall back into place as she ran. When she reached her front door, she stopped, smoothed down the hair around her face, and stepped daintily across the threshold. A2's loom was gathering evening shadows. A2 herself was setting the table with assorted plates and mugs and spoons. Rosemary's lettuce, drained of its water, sat in the middle of the table with crumbled, hard-cooked eggs scattered over the leaves. Althea was sliding cornbread onto a wooden board. Con sliced away at a heavily salted ham. Colin, the father of the family, his beard still damp from a wash outside, stepped in through the back doorway and smiled a special smile at Rosemary. "Let us sit," he said. And when all of his family were seated, Colin began to pray. "O Lord, I give you thanks for this meal and for the health of my good wife, myself, my daughters, Constance, Althea the Second, and Rosemary, and for all of the pleasures and joys of this day in the year of our Lord, 1790. Early evening was always a time of chores. After supper, Rosemary tended to her chickens. She carried a basket of corn into the backyard, tossed the kernels onto the ground, closed her eyes, and listened. She could almost always tell, by cackle, by grumble, which hen was coming home from the forest. Chloe, then Persephone, Jezebel, Portia. There was a lull in the hen talk, a mighty caroo. Rosemary opened her eyes. The rooster, Zeus, had arrived. He stood guard over corn and harem. With nothing but the power of his presence, he kept the hens waiting at the very edge of the scattering of corn. The last straggler, Rachel, arrived. Zeus stepped through his wives and pecked up a kernel. The hens lunged. They pecked, they quarreled, they stepped on each other's toes. When all the corn was gone, Rosemary heaved Zeus up into her arms. "Bedtime," she announced. With Zeus as proudly balanced as a cat, she led the hens into the henhouse. This was a special time of day for Rosemary. She almost always sat with her chicken friends while they settled for the night. Sometimes she talked to them. Sometimes she sang. Sometimes she closed her eyes and tried to imagine what they might dream. but all she could see behind her eyelids were specks of corn and forest bugs and the soft green shoots of spring. She could see all that just as well with her eyes open. "Would you like to hear the story of your name, Chloe?" she offered. But before she could begin, heavy feet came pounding down the wagon path. Within 2 seconds, Rosemary was out of the chicken house, the door latched. She raced Thomas Small for the big house. Thomas ran in through the front doorway. Rosemary skidded in through the back. Her mother and sisters turned from their tasks at the table and fireplace. Thomas bumped into A2's loom. Rosemary's father took his pipe from his mouth. "Thomas?" he said. "Pa sent me." Thomas was breathing so hard that his words had no edges. They sounded like the wind. "It's Bella. Calving. Trouble."
"Ease up, boy. Tell me, what trouble?"
"Calf won't come. Can't reach it. Bella's bleeding. Buckets."
"Oh, no," said Althea.
Colin put down his pipe. "Take this," said Althea, "and this." She grabbed herbs from the cupboard, from where they hung below the ceiling, and from where they were nailed beside the chimney.
"Thank you, ma'am," said Thomas.
"Break them in your hands," Althea directed Colin. "Rub them into a powder. Put it into the cow as far as you can reach. It will help the calf to come forth." Colin and Thomas, avoiding the loom, rushed out the back door. Althea, A2, and Rosemary all looked at Con. Con shook her head.
"I'm trying, but I can't hear her heartbeat. I think Bella is dead."
Althea sighed. A2 returned to banking the fire. Rosemary lingered by the table.
"Thomas didn't look at you," she said to A2.
"Thomas doesn't always look at me."
"Almost always." Rosemary was pert.
"Can't you keep her quiet, Mama?"
"Thomas is a fine young man," Althea said absently.
"Fine?" A2 exclaimed. "How can a man be fine if he doesn't wear shoes?"
Rosemary looked down at her own bare feet, and then at A2's. Rosemary's feet were actually cleaner.
"The Smalls are no wealthier than we are," said Althea. "They can't afford to wear shoes on every occasion."
"How can a man be fine," A2 argued, "if he isn't rich?"
"That's foolishness speaking."
Althea was sharp. A2's petulance collapsed like a punctured pig's bladder.
"He isn't special," she muttered.
"Thomas is the son of your father's oldest friend." Althea's voice ended the conversation. It was late now, late enough for bed. Rosemary went up the ladder stairs to the big attic room that she shared with her sisters. She lay down on her pallet and tried to see stars through the chinks in the roof. Then she sat up and pulled her box out of the wall. Sometimes the box was a place for treasures, but more often it was just a plug for a gap between two logs. Rosemary peered through the gap. She saw the sky. She saw stars. She saw Con walking back from the barn after checking on their own milk cow and the ox. Rosemary put the box back into its place. She went to sleep. When she awakened, the attic room was completely black. No moonlight or starlight came through any chink or gap. Rosemary wondered, briefly, what it was that had caused her to wake up. Her sisters were silent, motionless. Sleepily, Rosemary turned her head so that her ear moved closer to the plank floor. She closed her eyes again. She thought she heard someone quietly grieving, far below. But only her parents slept at ground level. "You're tired," it was her mother speaking, from the big bed beside A2's loom. Rosemary opened her eyes. "You feel it so because you're tired." "Oh, Allie." That was Rosemary's father. "They'll take the meat from the cow. They've lost her milk forever. There will be other milk cows. You didn't see it, Allie. All twisted and tangled inside its mother. Her innards ripped. It was a monster. A godless monster. A monster calf." "Did it live? How could it? With two heads?" Rosemary's eyes opened even wider. "It tore apart its mother. It killed its mother. And then it died just as we pulled it loose. I could have helped," Althea mused. "Never." There was panic in Colin's voice. "There are things that I could do, could have done. No one would have known." "No, Althea. Not that. Never. We'll help in the ordinary ways, with butter, with cheese, with friendship." Colin had control of his voice now. He was firm. The conversation continued, but along familiar lines. Colin hoped to finish his plowing the next day. Althea asked about the haying. Rosemary drifted back to sleep. She dreamt, not about two-headed calves, but about the rooster, Zeus. Zeus, standing on top of the woodshed, throwing hammers onto the ground, each hammer hitting the ground with a rumble, a roar, a Colin-like snore. The rumbles became louder, almost majestic. With each hammer, Zeus released a blaze of light. This time Rosemary was wide awake when she opened her eyes. She sat up and pulled her box from the wall. She saw the woodshed, without a rooster, momentarily lit from behind. Then she heard real thunder that easily drowned out her father's noisy sleep. Rosemary gasped as a ball of fire moved down a tree at the edge of the forest. The back door opened, and somebody stepped out onto the porch. Rosemary had to wait a moment to see that the somebody was her mother. Althea went to stand in the yard. The next clap, the next flash, happened together. The sound was as big as the farmstead. The flash aimed straight at the barn. Althea's hand moved upward as fast as fire. The lightning, in mid-journey, stopped. It doubled back on itself, shooting skyward, making an eerie hairpin of light. Althea pushed against the air with both hands. The next flash of lightning was over the river. The next clap of thunder was smaller, trailing the flash by a moment. The rain came, and Althea returned inside. Rosemary settled back upon her pallet. She could still hear her father's snores as background to the rainfall. Her sisters still slept. Rosemary felt very safe indeed. She turned onto her side, and she too slept the rest of the night away. Chapter 2. The Mill. Rosemary sat at the very back of the wagon, her legs dangling over the open edge, her petticoat spread out carefully beneath her as a barrier against the splinters. She could have sat up front with her father, where the wagon seat was well-planed and almost splinter-free. But she preferred to take her chances at the back. She enjoyed the special feeling that went along with leaving the countryside, as opposed to what a person felt upon arriving. Every flower or shrub or tree that Colin greeted, Rosemary said goodbye to. It was a sweet feeling, but also sad. The wagon bed behind Rosemary was filled with poles. Long, strong, supple poles that had been hickory saplings growing in swampy spots beside the river. Rosemary and Con had helped to cut them. Colin had soaked them in the river overnight. Now he was taking them to the mill. The miller's son would take the poles even farther up the river to the courthouse town, where he would sell them to the barrel maker. "The Lord protects us here below," sang Colin. "Our minds, our hearts, he will always know." Rosemary bounced happily. "Let us then our love increase," she joined in, "spite and anger thus to cease." She had her own reason to be contented. Somewhere at the head of the wagon bed, tucked beneath the poles, was a basket full of ginseng roots. The sundrop people believed that ginseng would keep them young forever. Rosemary, who feared that she would never be anything but young, had plans. With her ginseng money, she intended to buy sugar, brown sugar. The ox plodded onward. When it finally stopped, Rosemary hopped down from the wagon. While Colin unloaded the poles, she chased down to the mill pond, inspected the water for fish, and then dashed back to the wagon. She picked up her basket of ginseng, brushed off the front of her petticoat, and with sedate steps, preceded her father into the mill. "Good morning, Miller," she said, as gracious as any lady come to call. "Why, good morning, miss," the miller responded with equal graciousness. He winked at Colin. "And what might I do for you today?" Rosemary held up her ginseng basket, and the miller stepped away from his machinery. Rosemary inspected his feet. Underneath a thick coating of flour, white on top, black beneath, his feet were indisputably bare. She raised her nose higher. "I expect a good price now," she said. "But of course," the miller agreed. Rosemary put her basket down on the counter that was reserved for such transactions, and bare feet and high society forgotten, waited eagerly for the miller's verdict. Said the miller. He took root after root from the basket, inspecting each one. When he got to the big root, the root half as long as Rosemary's arm, he paused. "A big one," he said. "Very big. But dug too soon." "No," said Rosemary. "It's going to shrink," said the miller. "You know that, Rosie."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.